He was easy to tease. And he just didn't get it. It'd go over his head. And so it kind of became a project to tease him whenever he'd come in. Because he had a great smile. And liked his eyes. And, yeah. Actually, I met him at ATC while he was doing his UAs. And he's there about going for dinner. And we needed to go to dinner. I don't remember how the conversation started, but that was the end of it, was that we needed to go to dinner. And it kind of blew me off for a while.
Don't really remember. I was working a lot at the time.
You don't remember meeting your wife? I
kind of know, because we met almost 2 years ago. A little better than 2 years ago now. And it was just kind of, hi, how are you? Start with. And then I never really paid attention that she was hitting on me or trying to get my attention. I'd just go in, see her, and leave. When she got in my truck.
Yeah.
That sounds spicy. Now we're getting too spicy for
truck. No, I was actually, I was waiting for a coworker to pick me up for work, and he said, it's the white truck with the boy. So this white truck pulls up, and there's a boy, and I get in the truck, and I'm like, oh, you're definitely not who I thought you were. But then he just pulls off and starts driving away. I'm like, but he really just drove into the parking lot, so yeah. I had the stars of the darkest night. Yeah, we just wanted to do the paper and be simple. We're not real big, you know, extravagant type individuals. And we didn't want his family to be upset, and they wanted to participate and have a wedding, and so we just put together a little one. We went out there. My brother is actually an ordained minister, and he lives in Arizona, so he actually did it over the tablet. And yeah, so this is the first time my brother got to meet him. And so my brother just did it over the tablet, and I had a really good friend from church. He was kind of like my dad away from home. And so he walked me down the aisle, and we had a couple friends and his family, and it was just very simple. And after that, we went and did the cake and kind of hung out and just visited, and it was really nice. The same thing I would want today.
I would want again. You know, he seemed quiet, kind of timid, not really, didn't have a whole lot of sense of what to expect from him. He had come in with some sobriety, then he had some problems right off the bat, and picked up immediately and went forward from there.
You could see that he just was very closed off, introvert, and not really interested in things that were going on around him, but you could see that he had a lot of depth to him, and that's definitely not who he is anymore. I mean, he's still kind of an introvert and quiet, but he's a lot more outgoing and fun, and I enjoy just being around him all the time.
So we had actually had Jabez in treatment prior. I definitely thought he would be a good candidate. He just really needed probably the right support and really good to get some sobriety under his belt, because I think he has shown that he is a very, very intelligent person.
The first day he got out of ERT, he did relapse right away, but he was open and honest about it. He came in that following day. He told me he had messed up and relapsed, and then from there on out, he never had another slip up. He forged ahead, and it never kept following him. And he just was able to get on track right away, which was nice to see.
So I relapsed about 2 days out of inpatient. That was a lot to do with just getting out of inpatient, not really having anything set up for that first week. And pretty much the first thing I did was go out and find old friends.
You know, he stumbled out the door at the beginning of his time in drug court. He you know, had some issues, but he picked up right away and he never looked back from that point on. He focused his attention ahead and kept moving forward and has continued to move forward since that stumble.
I think it was him almost like kind of testing the waters to see that is this really going to be something that he is going to be able to do or not.
I was pretty disappointed. It wasn't the same as before as when I'd used. It wasn't, the high wasn't there, the satisfaction wasn't in it. Really, it wasn't as satisfying. So I got a hold of my probation officer, explained what happened, and just moved on from there. I closed myself off from basically everybody except for a handful of people. And my dad got me a job pretty much right away and started working.
He's a man of few words, but you know, he's been determined this whole time. He knows what he wants and he's just worked towards it. You know, he's made a lot of gains through this time, getting a vehicle, getting his own place, getting married.
You know, I think it's all right to move forward. Don't forget where you've come from. Don't forget how hard it was to get to where you got. And don't forget those people who helped you get there. And as you move forward, remember that and spread that. And be the kind of person who's going to help those who need the kind of help that you needed at one point. And, you know, for this program to be successful, that's really what we want to see, and that's really what we hope for. We always talk about, you know, the whole person, building the whole person. It's not just this piece of sobriety or this piece of having a job or having your home, but being the complete person, because when you become the complete person, you go out and do good things in our community, and that's really what we hope to accomplish in this program. So go out and be that whole person and help those around you.
You know, I think he already has kind of figured it out. I think that he really recognizes the life that he wants and what he needs to do to continue to get that and just kind of keep on the same track. He knows that we're all support here and that if there's ever anything he needs, he can always reach out to us.
I am very proud of him, actually. He's a hard worker. He's very thoughtful and kind. And really does put other people first, and I think that's a big part of sobriety too, is learning to not always take the upper hand or be selfish and very considerate.
I think a lot of it was the structure of everything, knowing I had to be accountable for myself and making myself accountable for that and having responsibilities that I couldn't get away from or find an excuse not to do.
I think it goes to kind of who he is. He's very intelligent. He's very capable. I would quite frankly say in the time that I've done the treatment court, he's probably one of the more intelligent individuals that we've come across. And I think the intelligence is driven in part by his desire to be successful. And I think that's just kind of what happened. He stumbled, he realized his mistakes, and then he moved forward. And he made a determination that he was never going to look back. And his desire to be successful and to kind of be at the top of things is kind of what's driven him, I believe.
Are you ever
going
to go back to that life again?
No.
Uh-huh. Looking forward to the future?
Yeah, eagerly. My name is Jabez. I have 677 days of sobriety. I do have a goal of owning a mountain in Alaska, like the whole mountain, just for myself.
You'd be really private out there, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
I hope we get a compliment.